Almost 100 people were government seats, sir.
Sir, we can start, sir.
Almost 130 people have joined, sir. We can start, sir.
Okay. Good afternoon to all. At the outset, I would like to thank ICON for taking this initiative of conducting a mock OSCE clinic for the exam going DNB and DM cardiology students. I think they are having the exam at the end of this month. So we'll be having two OSCE classes, one in this week and one another week on Monday. I would like to thank the faculty, Dr. Shanmugasundaram sir from Billroth Hospital. As ever, he is always our opener batsman for our clinical cardiology update. It is only sir who is the opening batsman, and he has been so for the past 11 years. Sir is always prompt in starting the session at the right time. And his contribution to teaching, you will come to know in another half an hour. Then I also invite my good friend Dr. T.R. Muralidharan sir, who is the HOD of Cardiology Department at Sri Ramachandra Medical College. Sir also is a very good teacher and a prolific speaker. So he'll also give you 15 OSCE questions after that. And following back that, I'll also present another 50 OSCE. So totally, you'll be having 45 OSCE questions, 15 from each of us. Once the question is displayed, we'll give you 1 minute time. You can have a paper and pen and write down the answer. And then after a 1 minute pause, sir will be giving you the answers. We hope to finish this in by 1 hour, 45 minutes to maximum 2 hours. Sir. Okay. Thank you. Over to you, sir, Dr. Shanmugasundaram, sir.
Thank you, Helen. Then you are able to see the slides?
Yeah, we are seeing the slides.
Okay. Dear friends, you know, welcome to this new experience. This is a new experience not only for you, but for examiners like us also. Now, from my side, I have 20 stations, each one with either an image or a video. Time for interpretation is generally 1 minute with each question, but for simple ones, I have kept half a minute. Please go through the images or videos, write down your answers within the allotted time. The right answer for each question will be given, based on which you can mark yourself. Let me start now with question number one. 34-year-old female coming with the left mammary pain radiating to left shoulder the last 4 hours. What's your diagnosis? And you should also substantiate based on what you make the diagnosis. Another 10 seconds to go.
Time up, sir.
Yeah. This is going to be the answer. ECG shows sinus tachycardia, low voltage complexes, diffuse ST elevation in most of the leads. What's important is absence of reciprocal ST depression in any of the leads except lead AVR, where you notice PR segment elevation and ST segment depression. In contrast, lead 2 shows PR segment depression. So PR elevation in AVR and PR depression in inferior leads is very suggestive of acute pericarditis. We'll go on to question number 2. 36-year-old male, dyspnea and effort class 2, asymptomatic, 110 by 80 millimeter of mercury arterial pressure, normal jugular veins, pulmonary ejection sound is present, P2 is loud, grade 3 by 6 CL diastolic murmur over left second intercostal space, increasing with inspiration. He is going through a right heart study. I'm going to show you the echo pictures. You need to mention what are the expected findings in your right heart cath. I don't want you to do everything, but at least give the pressures and oxygen saturation in right atrium, right ventricle, pulmonary artery, and aorta. These are the echo pictures with which you are going to the cath lab. Time starts now.
Time up, sir.
I have the answer here. If you could look at the echo pictures, you can notice significant right ventricular hypertrophy, D-shaped septum indicating high right ventricular pressure. You have tricuspid regurgitation as well as pulmonary regurgitation. Apart from pulmonary regurgitation, you can notice a flow into the pulmonary artery in diastole. This is coming from descending aorta. The diagnosis is patent ductus arteriosus with a right to left shunt in systole. I can even come to that again. If you carefully notice, this is the way you can make out a ductal shunt in the presence of severe PH. The blue ones indicate right to left shunt in systole. The red non-aliased flow from descending aorta into lateral aspect of pulmonary artery is the flow from descending aorta to the pulmonary artery that occurs in diastole. Now, these are the values I will get in right heart cath. The right atrium mean pressure is about 7 millimeter. As I mentioned, jugular venous pressure is normal. Right ventricular pressure 136 by 7. Pulmonary artery pressure 136 by 62. Aorta pressure is 110 by 78. If you look at the oxygen saturation, it's little desaturated in the systemic venous side. There is a small step up at pulmonary arterial level. And if you look at the oxygen saturation, ascending aorta to descending aorta, there is a significant step down. This is Eisenmenger syndrome in a patient with patent ductus arteriosus. Now, we'll go to question number 3. This is a female, 60-year-old person, palpitation and chest pain, syncope. The patient reports to the hospital within few minutes, and she was treated, and a few days later, an MRI was done. What is the diagnosis? And substantiate your diagnosis based upon the presence of typical findings. 1 minute is the time.
Time up, sir.
I'll give the answer for this. Right atrium and right ventricle are dilated. Carefully look at the right ventricular wall. It's thinned out. Look near the apex. There is some, you know, dyskinetic pouch-like thing here. And more than anything, look at the right ventricular outflow tract in this view. It's markedly dilated. So this combination, in the presence of symptoms like palpitation and syncope, suggests that the patient has presented with some ventricular arrhythmia. The diagnosis is arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. This is the ECG with which she came, broad QRS tachycardia, LBB morphology. After electrical cardioversion, the resting ECG showed mild ST elevation, but look at lead B3 for the characteristic epsilon wave. And these are the echo pictures. It is very difficult to make out the, you know, dyskinesia or akinesia or, you know, aneurysms and pouchings in 2D echo. Invariably, you may have to go for MRI to establish the diagnosis. And this patient had shown right atrial and right ventricular enlargement. And the one finding which gives you a clue in echocardiography is the short axis view. Look at right ventricular outflow tract. If somebody has mild to moderate right ventricular dilatation in the body with marked dilatation of the outflow tract, the diagnosis is very likely to be arrhythmogenic RV dysplasia. Looking at the features of revised task force, this patient has, you know, markedly dilated RV outflow tract and epsilon waves and sustained ventricular tachycardia of LVB morphology. So it fits in with the diagnosis of ARVC. The same patient, like, you know, when she presented with an arrhythmia, cardioverted, and the echo showed right heart dominance. Now, just based on the echo pictures, what are the things which will go through your mind to explain right heart dilatation, presuming that it is an adult congenital heart disease? Write down the adult congenital heart disease causes of right heart prominence. This is only for 30 seconds. Time starts now.
Time up, sir.
The answers are, apart from adult congenital heart diseases, you should consider pulmonary hypertension. Anyway, you'll be able to make a diagnosis based on the PA pressure estimated by Doppler echo. Some of the dilated cardiomyopathies may have predominant right heart dilatation, but it's quite unusual. If cardiomyopathy presents with predominant right heart dilatation, either it has to be predominant right atrial enlargement, think of endomyocardial fibrosis. If it is right atrial, right ventricular dilatation with much more prominent dilatation of RVOT, think of arrhythmogenic RV dysplasia. These are the following, and the following are the causes of prominent right heart when somebody has adult congenital heart diseases: ASD, partial anomalous pulmonary venous connection, AV fistula, coronary artery fistula into right heart, valvular dysfunction, primary TR, Epstein's anomaly, postoperative tetralogy of Fallot with significant PR, myocardial malformations like Wolff's anomaly, ventricular diverticulum. Taking the picture from the same patient, just mention the causes of white QRS tachycardia with the LBB morphology. Time allotted is only 30 seconds. The answers are RVOT tachycardia, bundle branch reentry, ARVC, Mahaim pre-excited tachycardia, and SVT with LBB aberrancy. From the same electrocardiography, another question is coming up. What are the key differences between the ventricular tachycardia of ARVC and that of RVOT tachycardia? 30 seconds.
Time up, sir.
Generally, a septal origin of VT is more often observed with idiopathic RV ventricular tachycardia, while in ARV it's generally from RV free wall. And not only that, multiple VT morphologies are common in ARV, while in RVOT tachycardia, single morphology is the characteristic feature. But what is important is post cardioversion ECG is absolutely normal in RVOT tachycardia, while ARVC may show epsilon waves, T inversion, V1 to V4, incomplete or complete RBB, localized QRS prolongation, confined to the right side leads. These are the features which may tell you that what you have dealt with is ARVC. Coming to question 7, give the complete diagnosis and hemodynamics based upon the echo videos and Doppler tracings which you have. Time is 1 minute. This is actually second part of the question, you know, or the clues. What you have is Doppler trace to go with whatever echo tracing which you had already seen. Pull everything together and come to conclusion. Since it has many tracings together in one slide, I will just go back for your sake. Just go through it quickly. Then the second part of the question, you have parasternal short axis view, fluorescent picture in systole, and you have a Doppler trace obtained from the RV outflow tract. Hope you have finished with the diagnosis. I'll give the complete diagnosis now. This is actually a post-operative VSD. You could see a prominent whitish structure here. This is the patch with which the VSD had been repaired. There is residual shunt. This is the left right shunt interrogated by the continuous wave Doppler. This is a 5 meter gradient across VSD. That means it's a small VSD. Right ventricular pressure is normal. Now here RV outflow is dilated. There is free flowing pulmonary regurgitation, as well as there is a significant tricuspid regurgitation. Tricuspid regurgitation is a low pressure TR, and look at the pulmonary regurgitation signal, steep deceleration slope, low pressure again. So this is postoperative VS with a residual defect, non-pulmonary hypertensive PR and TR with elevated right atrial pressure. Taking another question from the same echo tracings, just write down the echo indices of severe pulmonary regurgitation. It's only 30 seconds.
Time up, sir.
If you measure the jet of PR compared with the RVOT width, if it is more than 2/3 severe PR, if you demonstrate flow reversal in color flow mapping in left pulmonary artery, severe PR, pressure half time less than 100 milliseconds, this is PR index which is very familiar to you, duration of the PR jet divided by diastolic duration less than 0.7, severe PR, PR free time in diastole, that is like, you know, the PR ends here, this is PR free time in diastole. If it is more than 80 milliseconds, it is severe PR. There is one more PR index which had been described in olden days by M-Mode, shortly known as PR index by M-Mode echocardiography, PRIME. Pulmonary artery size in systole and diastole, if there is more than 40% variation, severe PR. You can also measure the velocity time integral of the regurgitant jet, compare it with the forward flow. If it is more than 0.61, it indicates severe PR. Question 8, it's a very simple one, 30 seconds only. Right ventricular systolic pressure is suprasystemic or systemic or below systemic, and tell the reason also.
Time up, sir.
This is a typical RV volume overload state because the septum becomes flat in diastole, but in systole, LV becomes circular. That means RV diastolic pressure is more than LV diastolic pressure, but RV systolic pressure is lesser than LV systolic pressure. This is typical volume overload state as evidenced by the M-Mode echocardiography. Like, you know, you can see a smooth transition. It moves inward in diastole, outward in systole, in contrast to what happens in normal people. This echo picture stands in contrast to the previous one. This is an example of pressure overload, where the D-shaped LV or the flat septum is there throughout the cardiac cycle, much more prominent in systole. Same thing in M-Mode, the paradoxical septal motion moving towards mitral valve in diastole, a brief outward movement in early systole, but look at end systole, there is much more prominent inward movement. This is what you see as a concave septum, not only flat, it is a concave septum. This indicates RV pressure overload. Now, echo, what is the diagnosis? And tell the hemodynamics as well. This is 1 minute. This is LVOT Doppler.
Time up, sir.
The answers are like, this is quite obvious, like, you know, interventricular septum is hypertrophied predominantly in the anterior septum as well as the free wall of the left ventricle. Since the basal septum is not hypertrophied, there is no obstruction, there is no SAM here. The LV outflow gradient is within 1 meter per second. But what is interesting is, look at the transmitral Doppler, where you can see a prominent mid-diastolic flow, otherwise called as L wave. The presence of L wave indicates raised filling pressures in the left ventricle. This is a form of diastolic dysfunction. Surprisingly, you can make out the same phenomenon in M-Mode echocardiography as well. remember that L wave should exceed 20 centimeter to be called as pathognomonic of diastolic dysfunction, and it should not occur in undue bradycardia, because if somebody with a normal heart, if there is undue bradycardia, you can get a L wave. And another hemodynamic feature is, because of the marked diastolic dysfunction, pulmonary artery pressure is elevated. So this is the completed diagnosis. Now, question number 10, 23-year-old female, short duration of severe dyspnea, delivered a female child 2 weeks ago, thin built, no Marfan features, BP 130/864, hyperdynamic apex, placed well outside and down, A2 is loud, grade 3/6 EDM along both right sternal border and left sternal border, with a short MDM over the apex. I have to show some more echo pictures. This is the apical five chamber. This is the Doppler pattern of AIR jet. And this is obtained by keeping the pulse Doppler over the isthmus from suprasternal window. M-mode echocardiography at the level of mid left ventricle. I'll go to the answer now. The clinical picture itself, when there is a prominent EDM, both along right sternal border and left sternal border, think of dilated aorta, which is confirmed by parasternal long axis view. The diagnosis is anuloaortic ectasia, which generally goes with Marfan syndrome, or it could be a formiferity of Marfan syndrome. But what is interesting in this patient is, look at the suprasternal window. You can see some thickened aortic wall, the thoracic aorta, proximal thoracic aorta. This is the one which makes it a distinctive etiology for the vascular aortic regurgitation. CT aortogram, which gives you the dilated ascending aorta. There are areas of narrowing as confirmed by MRI also. And free-flowing aortic regurgitation, markedly dilated aorta. She was operated, and the histopathological confirmation is Takayasu arteritis. Now, question 11, 30 seconds. It's very simple, though I have marked it as 1 minute. 58-year-old male, CKD, on hemodialysis, give the complete diagnosis.
Time up, sir.
The answer is the presence of left ventricular hypertrophy is obvious. This is mitral annulus calcification. This is also quite obvious. But look at the center. There is some echolucent area here, as well as this space here. Everywhere you can see a echolucent space. This is caseating mitral annulus calcification. Though it is called caseation, it is not true caseation in the histopathology. It is only liquefaction of the calcified material in the mitral annulus. The importance is this is more prone to embolize, either de novo or with a superadded thrombus on it. Question 12 is a very simple one. A benign condition, relatively benign condition, MRI, make the diagnosis.
Thank you. time up, sir.
You might have heard about this lipomatous hypertrophy of atrial septum. Coming back to the MRI pictures, if you look at these two zones, sparing the fossa valvulus part of atrial septum, this is just lipomatous deposits, and significant deposits have been noticed in the AV group as well. Actually, this patient, this is a dumbbell shaped thing. Generally, it does not produce any symptoms, but it can cause SVC syndrome. If somebody has a massive lipomatous hypertrophy, it can be a cause of atrial arrhythmias. And for interventional cardiologists, it may be an obstacle. It may be an obstacle for a surgeon when he puts in a cannula during cardiopulmonary bypass. This is the practical importance of a lipomatous hypertrophy of atrial septum. Remember that it is different from lipoma. Lipoma is a well-encapsulated tumor. It may not be present on either side of the atrial septum. If it is present on either side of the atrial septum like this, it is lipomatous hypertrophy. Echo of the same individual, look at the AV groove. Actually, we made a diagnosis of some mass in the atrioventricular groove, and that's how she went in for MRI. Now, this is a pulmonary arteriogram. Mention the diagnosis with supporting findings. You need to mention on what basis you make the diagnosis. Time is 1 minute.
Time up, sir.
Yeah. Dilated pulmonary arteries with the pruning of branches, it indicates that there is significant pulmonary hypertension. But look at these areas where pulmonary artery branches are abruptly cut off here, and you can, the descending branch of the left pulmonary artery, you can also make out a localized constriction here. These are all features of thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension. The described findings are pouch defects, intimal irregularities, abrupt narrowing with a rat tail appearance, and presence of web or band-like structures in the pulmonary artery. And this CMR, cardiac MRI, helps you to explain a bedside sign. I think the time allotted is just 10 seconds only, because it's quite obvious. Hope you have mentioned the answer. I'll give the answer now. Look at the aortic regurgitation jet striking at the anterior mitral leaflet, and AML movement is restricted because of the jet striking at the AML, narrowing the mitral orifice, and this is responsible for the Austin Flint murmur. Now, RVOT Doppler, take only 30 seconds to answer. There is something which is abnormal in RVOT Doppler here. How is it produced, and what is the diagnostic value?
Time up, sir.
Notching of RVOT Doppler is a very important thing which you should look for in patients with pulmonary hypertension. The importance is it does not generally occur in group 2 pulmonary hypertension, that is left heart diseases producing pulmonary hypertension generally doesn't produce this sign. Rare exceptions are there, but whenever there is a mid-systolic notching, it tells you that the PVR is higher than 3 wood units. and it is supposed to be caused by reflected waves from the periphery, something like what happens in the augmentation of central aortic pressure. Same thing happens in pulmonary artery also in the presence of increased pulmonary vascular resistance. Not only that, proximal pulmonary arteries are also stiff because of long-standing elevation of PA pressure. Another practical importance is earlier the peak, higher the pulmonary vascular resistance. There are some who believe that very early peak tells you that it is likely to be thromboembolic PH, but I think there is significant overlap between thromboembolic and idiopathic PH. Very, very simple one. I'm giving only 5 seconds. What is happening? Why? How are you going to treat this? Answer is very straightforward. It's a prosthetic valve thrombus immobilizing the posterior disc. We have given thrombolysis, though the optimal method is tricuspid thrombus, always thrombolyze. Mitral and aortic thrombus, if it is large, early surgery. If it is small or if it is recent onset, go for thrombolysis. But the problem with our setup is, like, you know, the access to the emergency surgery in a sick patient. So most of them go for thrombolysis. I will skip this for want of time. Come to the last one. Pressure tracing. 38-year-old female, class 3 dyspnea, elevated AVP with a steep X and Y descents, no murmur. Give the diagnosis with substantiation. 1 minute. This is going to be my last question. I'll go for the answers. If you look at the dip and plateau pattern of at least LV pressure, restrictive physiology is obvious. Look at the LV pressure and RV pressure. They are not within 5 millimeters of mercury within each other. They separate out. LV pressures are a little higher. Look at RV systolic pressure. It is close to 60. Some degree of pulmonary hypertension is present. These are all suggestive of restrictive cardiomyopathy. But what is more important is respiratory concordance of ventricular pressures. During inspiration, both LV pressure and RV pressure come down. In expiration, both LV pressure and RV pressure go up. This gives you the diagnosis of restrictive cardiomyopathy. I'll stop with this. Thank you. Murali, you are going to do it or Elan is going to do it?
I'm going to do it. Elan, you have to unmute.
Thank you, Shanmugasundaram sir, for the wonderful spotters that you presented. I hope it will be very useful for them for the future examination. And next, Dr. Murali will be presenting.
Yeah. Can you stop sharing, sir? I will start sharing. Can you allow me? Dhananjan, can you allow me to share?
Yeah. Allowed. Enabled.
Time issue.
Thank you. Hi, good evening, friends. First of all, I should thank everyone and Tupla sir for allowing me in this, to be with you in this podium, number one. In fact, I learned a lot of points from Tupla sir. Sir is my teacher and remains a teacher always. It's a wonderful day. So I will, my talk is going to be more in the range of straightforward questions on some cases today. I will start with the one case which has a little relation to what Tupla sir showed a few minutes ago. 25 years old male, came with intermittent palpitation for 2 days. Frequent, only for a few minutes, associated with giddiness. Clinical examination was normal. Nothing, no abnormality could be found, be identified. As we started doing an ECG, fortunately, we had a tachycardia while doing the ECG, which you can see now. This is the ECG. So what is the diagnosis? Same patient ECG after the arrhythmia terminated, both done within minutes. In the spend some time on this ECG, think about the diagnosis. We'll go to the next ECG now. The second ECG. Oh, sorry, I didn't put the option. I was drawing this ECG while sir was giving the talk. The points of importance is the white cast tachycardia, number one. So, are you able to see my pointer?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
You are seeing a white cast tachycardia, left ventricular block morphology. There are several algorithms. For want of time, I am not going to go to the details of that. But a simple one, as you see the rhythm shift down, you can see the baseline and the QRS is being marked by intermittently occurring P waves. So a simple identification of the AV dissociation. The P waves are occasional. QRs are frequent, tells you there's a VA dissociation, AV dissociation, straight away puts you into ventricular tachycardia. So I'll discuss in that left ventricular block morphology with ventricular tachycardia, various causes. In this patient, you can see now, within the background of in the mind, if you see the V1, you can see an RSR pattern. If you look carefully, the terminal thing is not a typical RSR, rather a slurring of the terminal end of the QRS complex, which we call epsilon wave. Most of the time, the epsilon wave will be inconspicuous one like this. At least it can be very prominent one like this. This is not this patient, another patient, but for learning purpose, I brought in here. A typical epsilon wave can be very prominent at times. May not be all the time. That is what the point of importance we have to learn. And this is the MRI of the patient. So I have shown the echo on the of this patient. You can see the dilated right ventricle, lobulations, areas of outpouchings, typical of arrhythmogenic RV cardiomyopathy. We know the treatment, what to do in these patients. So moving to other questions, is a 50-year-old male, diabetic, old anterior-LMI, 50-year-old male, diabetic anterior-LMI, severe LV dysfunction and triple SL disease, undergoing a CABG, and come back to the hospital after 2 weeks with dyspnea. So post-operative CABG for a triple SL with LV dysfunction, come back after a few weeks. What do you see here? We can start the timer, sir. Let me know after 30 seconds. This is an echocardiogram. I will go to the question and come back to the echocardiogram again. What is the diagnosis? What is the management?
Time up, sir.
Yeah. If you look carefully, sir, the why I showed this is one of the medical emergency or even a interventional emergency wherein for a casual look, it may look like a four-chamber view with showing a linear thrombus-like structure. But if you look carefully, what you are seeing is the RV free wall is not RV free wall, rather the pericardium. It is a severe regional cardiac tamponade where the entire right ventricle and the right atrium have become a stick-like structures. This patient needs an urgent pericardial centrosis. It's a cardiac tamponade, regional tamponade, most likely considering the history of the recent surgery, post-MI, post-CABG, Dressler syndrome, and early pericardial centrosis is the treatment of choice in this situation. Coming to the next case, here we have a 64-year-old male, diabetic, hypertensive, chest pain on and off, comes with a history suggestion of a CVA, slurring of speech with right side upper and lower limb weakness for 3 days, vital stable, normal hot zone, no murmur, and the AEC showed an atrial MI, MRI showed a subacute infarct in the left MCI territory until the echo. Time starts, maybe 20 seconds should be enough for this. And another straightforward problem in our day-to-day practice. See the thing, and the question is, what is the diagnosis? What is the role of NOVAX in this condition? The newer oral anticoagulation, what is the role of NOVAX in this condition? I'll call you back 2 minutes in the webinar.
Time up, sir.
So it's an LV apical clot with a cerebroembolic manifestation. Role of NOVAX, it's an off-label indication. The point to remember, standard treatment is anticoagulation, either parenteral in acute stage if the neurological status allows, and long-term oral anticoagulation. Typically, we have a vitamin K antagonist only we have to consider. NOVAX being tried as an off-label indication. Third thing, 53-year male, diabetic, complains of epigastrial and retrosternal chest discomfort for 3 days, and NYHA class 3, breathlessness. And on examination, you see there is a tachycardia, hypotension, the pan-systolic murmur, the left lower sternal border, and ECG fixture, infial MI. What is the diagnosis? Thirty seconds should be enough, sir. Some more views. So, what is the diagnosis? What are the risk factors that can predispose to this condition, and what is the management? For one time, I'm just going, sorry, I didn't pose the questions now. But the diagnosis is, as you saw, ventricular septal rupture, large left right shunt, ventricular septal rupture, and large left right shunt. And the risk factors that predispose to the condition are usually in patients with chronic kidney disease, women, elderly patients, long-standing hypertension. These are some of the common predisposing conditions. Surgery is most of the time recommended. Very rare we think of conservative management. Device closure can be attempted if the anatomy is feasible. Moving to another complication, again, diabetic, hypertensive, comes with class 4 dyspnea. The impending respiratory arrest, referred to our hospital. When the patient comes, patient is having hypotension, needs a lot of inotropes, pulmonary edema like picture with a pan-systolic murmur. We can, the question, I'll come to the question, what is the diagnosis and what is the initial non-surgical management? So you can see the echoes one by one, I'll run it. What is the diagnosis and what is the initial non-surgical management? 40 seconds maybe you may do, sir, 40, 45 seconds. Forty-five seconds should be sufficient. Color Doppler of the same patient. Because what we are seeing is a transesophageal echocardiogram. The diagnosis, before I go, what it to be shown, spend some time on the echo. The point of importance is this patient in a transthoracic obese lady, we could not locate the pathology very clearly, but in a transesophageal echocardiogram, you can see a complete papillary muscle rupture, including the head of the papillary muscle. That's what we are seeing in this situation. So, this is an important thing you should know. Papillary muscle rupture is one of the major complications where an early surgery will be of a great help in the situation. That's the important thing you should know. And what you are seeing here is you can see the complete flail mitral leaflet with the head of the papillary muscle attached to that. Commonly, it involves the inferior wall myocardial infarction. And the treatment is almost all the time surgical management. You can try an initial medical stabilization by using off-roll reduction and intra-aortic balloon pulsation. These are things going to help to mitigate the situation till the patient is taken up for surgery. The reason I showed all these things in an order was these are the mechanical complications we come across in our myocardial infarction patients where an early treatment helps most of the time. But despite treatment, sometimes we could not save the patient and we end up in losing the patient. But we should be aware of this complication while treating patients with acute myocardial infarction. Moving a little, 65-year-old inferior MI patient, inferior MI present after thrombolysis, patient taken up for pharmaco-invasive approach for PCI. So, little moving away from acute situation, the inferior MI, pharmaco-invasive approach, thrombolysis is done. We have taken up for an angioplasty, and this is an angioclip taken during the procedure. I'll go to the question and come back to this. What is the diagnosis? I'm going to show the video now. And what is the classification of this condition? Is there any known classification? So now you can see the angiogram. So during PCI, after a pharmaco-invasive approach, I mean, part of a pharmaco-invasive approach in inferior MI. Thirty or forty seconds should do, sir. Okay. What I'm seeing here is one of the major complications you come across during angioplasty, dissection of the right coronary artery at the ostium. You can see the flap also. Apart from that, the dissection extending proximally to the aortic root. You can see the right coronary cusp, the dissection extends and the dye is staying there. You can see very well one of the reasons for that. Unavoidable at times is the catheter what we are using, the Amplatz catheter. This is one of the complications while doing PCI. The person who classified is Dunning. Dunning classified this into three types wherein what you saw is the type 1 where ostial dissection extending up to the aortic root alone. When the extension in the aorta goes to ascending aorta up to 40 millimeter, we call type 2 aorta ostial dissection. When it is more than 40 millimeter, you have to think of type 3, more than 40 millimeter. The importance is type 1 like this can be controlled by an immediate stenting, even an uncovered stent also at times. But type 2 and type 3 needs a careful observation, and type 3 most of the time they need an emergency surgery. So the point of learning is remember the complication, and Dunning is the one who classified this into various types. Shifting away from the angiogram, an ECG here. Straightforward, an ECG. Tachycardia, what is the diagnosis and what is the management? 30 seconds or 40 seconds will do that, 40 seconds. This is one of the garden variety ECG we often use in our classes and in the exam. What you are seeing is a narrow cross tachycardia. A careful observation shows like the picket fence appearance or a sawtooth appearance in the inferior leads, upright P waves, and you can see the inverted P waves in the inferior leads. Typical atrial flutter. Typical counterclockwise atrial flutter. is the diagnosis, and you can see the rate most of the time the atrial rate will be should be by rule 240, and the ventricular rate when the 2:1 classically stays at around 150 per minute. So these are the clues, but see this pattern, never forget the atrial flutter. The treatment is, of course, there are other treatment. Look at the underlying cause, is it acute or transient precipitating factor? But if not, it is one of the eminently suitable arrhythmia for EP study and the RFA, where the success rate is more than 90% today. Moving to a different type of ECG, have a look at the ECG. The question is, what is the diagnosis and what is the next line of management in this patient? 45 seconds we can give for this ECG, sir. So a young girl comes with history of syncope, and it's a routine ECG when the patient was asymptomatic.
Time up, sir.
Yeah, what you are seeing here is sinus rhythm. You can see the QRS morphology mildly varies, but spend time on the STT segment. You can see the change in the T wave amplitude morphology from beat to beat, evident in several leads. Particularly if you spend time the rhythm stream, you can see there is a T wave morphology changes. But much more important is it changes not only with that, but with the increase in the QT interval. So this patient has a QT interval of, you can see the measurement we have internet while measuring also, it is more than 500. In fact, QTC is 586. So a long QT syndrome with the macro TVA alternates. These are what the higher risk for sudden cardiac death or complications, but still there's a big role for medical treatment. The mainstay of therapy going to be beta blockers. Other treatment like sympathetic ganglionectomy or ICD can be resolved for those patients who do require it. So the diagnosis here is long QT syndrome, macro TVA alternates, beta blocker the mainstay of therapy. Think of other intervention as needed. Moving little into electrophysiology again, you are seeing an angiogram taken the cath lab. The question is, describe the angiogram. What procedure is being done? Again, 40 seconds should be enough. 40 or 40 seconds should be enough, sir. Take time, look at the angiogram.
Time up, sir.
Yeah. What you are seeing is one of the interventional procedure in device implantation. What we are accessing is the coronary sinus. It is a coronary sinus. The delivery sheath is the coronary sinus. You can see the posterior lateral vein, the target wherein we try to place a lead. So this is a procedure being done here is a CRT or cardiac recirculating therapy, wherein we are going to leave a lead in the right ventricle and right atrium and one little in the LV. You all know today, as your exam going, we are not only doing recirculation therapy by using a lead in the coronary sinus or veins or epicardial, we are moving into left bundle branch and also into east bundle position also. We will discuss in the coming meeting if time permits. But this is a coronary sinus venogram. It is used for many other purposes during electrophysiology. But here, this angiogram is taken to identify the vein to place the LV lead. Shifting again, moving away from the arrhythmias, the ECG something. This is a middle-aged lady with acute onset breathlessness. What is the diagnosis what is the name of the thing, what is the next line of management if hemodynamically unstable. Only three questions. See the echo. So acute breathlessness. What is the diagnosis? What is the name of the sign? And what is the next level of management in an unstable patient? 30 seconds may do, sir.
Time up, sir.
Thank you. What you are seeing is a four chamber view, right atrium and right ventricle capacity dilator. You can see the RV is hypokinetic, but a careful evaluation shows the RV apical segment alone contracting normal. Classical thing we see, what we call McConnell sign, one of the sign to think of, to consider pulmonary embolism as first diagnosis. So this is a case of pulmonary thromboembolism, and treatment is most of the time in the hemodynamically unstable patient. Straight thrombolytic therapy. Very rarely we consider surgery. So the classical echo of pulmonary embolism. This ECG is of an elderly person, around 65 to 70 years, elderly person, who had history of giddiness, and you can see the, I'm going to show the next ECG also. It is 2007, 9th April 2007, 12 lead ECG, you can see the limb leads, you can see the pericardial leads, and same patient, 20th December 2007. This is April 2007. This is December 2007. So look at both the ECGs. Think about what it could be. What are the possibilities? We'll come back to the discussion in 30 seconds. ECG one. ECG two. The ECG 2 and taken on the same patient for a period of 5 to 6 months.
I'm not sure.
Thank you. See, what you are seeing in this patient is you are seeing a normal sinus rhythm. The AV conduction seems to be all right, but if you look carefully, there is a left ventricular wall block. Without doubt, there is a left ventricular wall block. Same patient, again here also, patient seems to be having a literally normal PR interval, little longer than the previous one, little longer than the previous one, maybe 30 to 40 milliseconds more, with a right ventricular block pattern. And there's a tiny Q wave also in V1, which should be given credence. Of course, this patient has history of old TABG, triple-related disease. But the point of importance is, you can see in the same patient, sinus rhythm, left ventricular block complete, can become sinus rhythm, right ventricular block complete. The common logic we think is, once a left bundle block, then a right bundle comes, they end up in complete heart block. That idea should be, has been challenged for several decades. The learning point is, it is decided by which bundle is more diseased. So there can be a situation where left bundle can be diseased showing left ventricular block. As the time goes, the right bundle involvement is more. Even the left bundle is diseased, even though it is diseased, the impulse tries to permeate through the left bundle. The right bundle is more severely diseased than the left bundle. So you can have an alternating bundle-bunch block, but these are the patients where we think of severe infra-ECM disease. The need for pacemaker will be high. Of course, this is a nearly 13, you have seen 2007, nearly 13 years. This patient underwent a pacemaker within 2 months after the second ECG. Just to enlighten you that the bundle-bunch block can be alternating at times. Moving to a few interventions, we'll come back to the video clip. Again, we can give for 30 seconds, sir. But the question is, what are the contraindications for this procedure? And what are the alternative approaches for deployment of the device? Have a look at it.
Time up, sir.
Yeah. What you're seeing is a deployment of PDA device. Amplar is the one like thing. Several companies are coming with a similar model, a similar design. The device being deployed at the doctors. This is just at the time the device is deployed and the device getting released from the site. You can see the delivery cable is being pulled inside the sheath. The point of importance is to do this, two things remember. One is, in patients who are dependent on PDA, you can't do this. Of course, we may not think, remember the thing. Other thing is, severe pulmonary artery hypertension. Of course, things like acute infection or endocarditis involving doctors, we may not consider. Severe pulmonary hypertension going to Eisenmenger also, you may not consider these things. Rarely you can use arterial route or you can use a railroading technique or you can use the Amplar 2 or 3 in the arterial route also, you can deploy the same device. Moving to another device deployment, just to enlighten you, you have got three videos taken successively during the procedure. The middle one is the first one. This one is the second one and this is the last one. The question is, ECG indication for complication during the procedure. You need only 20 seconds for that. Look at the videos, but point is, what are the ECG indicators that will suggest that there is something going on? Of course, this procedure was uneventful. ECG indicators for complications.
Time up, sir.
Yeah, what you are seeing is an atrial septal defect being closed with a device. The indicator you have to think will be, one is acute ischemic changes, particularly inferior MA like pattern can happen due to several reasons. One of the reason, commonest reversible reason is air embolism, but other causes can occur. Benign VPCs, but if they occur during deployment, immediately after deployment, always remember the device could have embolized into the ventricle. So VPCs which appear benign for most of the time, a post ASD closure, if there's a VPC, be alarmed that the things may not be good. Sometimes we may prevent a fatal reaction. There's another patient who comes with ECG of this sort with giddiness. This is a ECG. I'll come back. The question is, what is the diagnosis? What is the next line of management? There's some learning points in this. An elderly male coming with an ECG of this sort and giddiness only. No other symptoms. 20 seconds should do, sir. 20 or 25 seconds.
Time up, sir.
Thank you. What we are seeing here is a complete heart block. If you carefully start analyzing the rest strip, you see a regularly occurring P waves, AV dissociation. Contrary to the first ECG we saw, here the atrial rate is quite high, just nearly 120 or 130, and the ventricular rhythm is slow. Regularly occurring ventricular rhythm seems to be unconnected to the atrial rhythm, complete heart block. And you look at the QRS morphology, it's a left ventricular block morphology. So a wide QRS rhythm, complete heart block, in the person symptomatic, we always consider probably a significant infra-ECM disease, which can come due to acute or chronic situation. The line of management is going to be early pacemaker, temporary pacemaker insertion, and start assessing the patient for further treatment. The new patient, the moment you put a temporary pacemaker, keep observing, look at other reports. But the story doesn't end there. It is a very simple, straightforward, compare block. The story is, the temporary pacemaker was inserted for this patient, ECG was recorded. After 3 hours, another ECG was recorded. This is the ECG immediately after putting the pacemaker. And the next ECG is this. So what does this show? What is the diagnosis? Why there is no pacing the second ECG? What is the next line of management? So this is the ECG taken immediately after putting a temporary pacemaker. Now we are seeing an ECG after some hours. Now you have to tell me why there is no pacing spike seen, number one. What is the diagnosis? What is the next development? Thirty seconds, sir.
Time up, sir.
Thank you. See, if you look carefully, initially we saw a classical Bundermann block with Weierstrass rhythm. Always we think of chronic CHP, put a temporary pacemaker, but as we are seeing the patient more, when the rhythm occurs, here what you are seeing is a junctional rhythm. The temporary pacing usually kept at a rate of 70 or 80. In this patient, if you see, they are kept exactly at 70 per minute. When the heart rate increases more than 70, naturally a demand pacemaker in a VVA mode will get inhibited. So it is not a surprising thing to find that the pacemaker is not functioning or not emitting spikes. We are naturally giving inhibitor as it is sensing a rate more than 70. But if you look carefully, even now, there is AV dissociation. If you see the P waves are regularly occurring, again at a faster rate, but you see a junctional beat or a ventricular escape rhythm, which is also happening regularly. There is the AV dissociation, there is a complete heart block going on. But in addition to that, we are sort of realizing that the QRBVV. A typical anti-LMI pattern, QRBBV, typical anti-LMI pattern in the escape junction rhythm. So the learning point is, this patient has come with acute coronary syndrome, surprisingly presenting himself with a complete heart block, which is not uncommon, though it is rare, has presented a complete heart block needing temporary pacemaker, but within hours developing anti-LMI, typical future who needs intervention. Remember these type of patients. We always think complete block is common in patients inferior MI. Yes, it is true. But it can happen in anterior MI also. Many of the time, it's a large infarction, multivessel disease, or a pre-existing RCA or multivessel disease should be considered. These are the patients at higher risk. The older teaching or learning pre-thrombolytic or early thrombolytic era was that the prognosis is very bad in this people despite the treatment. But interventions, coronary interventions, PCI have changed, made a big change in this. So these are the patients where an intervention are timely will make the patient to survive or to lead a normal life. And the point of importance is, remember this, whenever you put a temporary pacing, follow up with an ECG, keep seeing the patient regularly and repeat ECG whenever needed. Two more ECGs, 45-year-old female presenting with, sorry, is a pneumonia tracing, 45-year-old female presenting with dyspnea on and off for 10 years, exertional. Following is a hemodynamic trace during the procedure. Exertional dyspnea undergoing interventional procedure. This is a tracing. We can give solid 45 seconds to 1 minute, sir. Spend some time on the tracing, the typical tracing that we see in our cath lab. The question is, what is the likely diagnosis? What is the procedure being done? And what is the reason for prominent B wave in LA trace? To label it, what we are seeing is the atrial tracing in the blue color, and the red color is a ventricular tracing. And you have an ECG gating also. In these type of tracings, one tip you always carry is look for these beautiful ectopics. They give you a longer time, and the post-ectopic pause gives a lot to learn. You can spend some time on the visual treat.
1 minute up, sir.
Thank you. What we are seeing here is in LV tracing and LA tracing with ECG gating, if you look carefully, the A wave, the V wave seen in every beat. The V wave is quite taller than the A wave, number one. But if you spend some time here, particularly after the post-ectopic and every bit, you can say LEA pressure is very low. LEA pressure is very low, number one. Number two, there is no big gradient between left atrium and left atrial during diastole. I said this patient came with history of dyspnea, undergoing a procedure and tracing is done after the procedure. So most likely, you always have to think for this gradient. So the probable procedure you have to think of will be a percutaneous transmitter transceptor, and the tall V wave, it can be due to poor LEA compliance, or you have to always consider the possibility of mitral regurgitation. It can be a mild mitral regurgitation to think, but always remember a tall V wave you see immediately post procedure, think of mitral regurgitation, but a poor compliance also can produce a tall V wave. So there is a patient who underwent PTMC. Another interventions, 30-year-old male present with compliance of cough and dyspnea and hemoptysis is noted. He undergoes one, not a ECG, not a echo, not a CAT, but a CT. This is a single frame. We are seeing a CT cross-section. You can see that the right ventricle, left ventricle. Spend some time. The question is, what is the diagnosis? What is the next line of management? Male present with compliance of cough and dyspnea, hemoptysis is noted. 30 seconds, sir.
Time up, sir.
Yeah. This is one of the rare case where what you are seeing is a classical pseudoaneurysm being picked up. Of course, the additional pulmonary changes also, which explains the cough and dyspnea, also known to occur. This patient had a complete MI with a pseudoaneurysm. We saw in our tracings every other mechanical complication. A CT image of pseudoaneurysm where an urgent surgery will be needed because the rupture can be fatal in this patient. Resection patch repair was considered. Moving back to hemodynamics a little, 10-year-old boy admitted with complaints of fatigue. The following is the hemodynamic trace during intervention. So again, another child undergoing an intervention. This is a hemodynamic trace. Have a look at that. I will have to show the next tracing also. This is the tracing taken during the procedure, and this is the tracing taken after the procedure. Okay, what you are seeing is the ECG gating and the LV and aorta tracing, and this is during the procedure. Take 1 minute, sir. I'll be showing both the tracings in 10 seconds, one after the other. Take 1 minute, we'll decide what. Think of what is the procedure being done. What is the diagnosis? What is the diagnosis? What is the procedure? During the procedure. Is maybe at the end of the procedure. Just doing the procedure.
One minute up, sir.
Okay. What we are seeing here is a significant gradient between the LV pressure and the aortic pressure. Significant gradient seen in almost all the beats. Fortunately, and believe me, it happens more often while doing a procedure. Frequent VPs is attained even as in the bigeminal fashion. But the post-ectopic beat does not show the typical Brockenborough phenomena. The gradient persists. There's a potentiation, post-ectopic potentiation is seen at the LV tracing, typical of a LV outflow tract obstruction. And here, after the procedure, the tracing shows minimal gradient between the LV tracing and aortic tracing, but there is a delay in the aortic waveform pattern also, the phasic delay. Everything suggests that this patient has had probably a aortic valve stenosis. Remember, this is not a Brockenborough effect. That is why we are posing this. The treatment being done in this patient is balloon aortic valvuloplasty. Young child, though we don't always advocate balloon aortic valvuloplasty in many patients, considering the age, we use this as palliative measures. This is a 23-year-old male. Maybe another few minutes, Ellen, I can stop whenever you say Dhananjayan.
Yes, sir.
We are also running late means. 23-year-old male, present with complaints of dyspnea on exertion. The following is the echocardiogram. This is the echocardiogram. What is the level of obstruction? What is the surgical procedure done to this condition? It is only 20-25 seconds should be enough. You can see the echocardiogram. The Doppler sample volume is kept at the LV outflow tract. Things are very obvious.
Time up, sir.
Thank you. What we are seeing is a classical Doppler tracing in a person who has got a significant LV hypertrophy with a Dagger shape. Is a hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. The dynamic subval obstruction, the dagger shaped tracing will tell you. The surgical procedure being considered in this is Morrow procedure or myectomy, myomectomy. Next patient, 27-year-old male with cyanosis since 12 years of age. What is the procedure being, what is the test being done, and what is the diagnosis? What is the diagnosis? And the patient has telangiectasia. That's the obvious clue. What is the diagnosis? You can wait up to 45 seconds, I think, sir. I should thank my colleague Dr. Preetam to give this wonderful echo. This is a contrast echo what you are seeing. I have given the clue also. Keep looking at it. Thank you. This is a contrast echo, what we are saying. We do not use usually a typical commercial echo contrast, rather agitated saline only. If you see in the initial part, as the bubble starts appearing in the right atrium and right ventricle, wait for the next turn, you can see the left is also filling, but after the pass. It is not coming immediately, maybe after 3 to 5 beats. You can see now, empty. Right atrium fills. Fifth beat, we are getting the left. An intracardiac shunt, you would have seen the bubbles appear in the left side immediately. The fact that here the right atrium and right ventricle, the contrast fills with a pass of more than 4 to 5 seconds, and the left side also fully filling, always says that there is a shunt, right to left shunt occurring at a intrapulmonary or extracardiac level. If the patient has a telangiectasia, the diagnosis will be obvious. So always consider pulmonary AV malformation. Hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia with the pulmonary involvement is one of the conditions which can produce similar picture. Some more cases, 58-year-old lady, diabetic, hypertensive, known CKD on dialysis, presents with acute pulmonary edema, this is the ECG. Maybe we can stop with this, I think. This is the ECG. What is the drug of choice to be administered? What is the next line of management? So, CKD patient on dialysis, diabetes, hypertensive, comes with pulmonary edema. 30 seconds will do, sir. 30 or 40 seconds. One of the scary ECG you can see.
Time up, sir.
Thank you. Bizarre looking ECG, very wide QRS rhythm, doubtful P wave at time seen or not clearly seen, something like what we use the term sine wave, a classical of hyperkalemia. And potassium was touching nearly 8 milliequivalents. This is a typical dialysable current of injury, so hemodialysis will be a curative one, or you can try to the crisis immediately, but before that, in the acute situation, remember, calcium procalcate will be considered an antidote. Sodium bicarbonate or sometimes glucose insulin infusion can help to overcome or mitigate and buy some time till you go for a early dialysis. So a typical scary hyperkalemia is the case. I'll stop here to meet you again in the next phase, but I'm going to be with you to learn from Dr. Elilan. Thank you for your patient listening. Thank you, Father Agri. Thank you, Elilan. Thank you, Triple S. Stop here.
Thank you, Dr. Murli, for the wonderful spotters. I'm sure it will be a treat for the postgraduates. So I'll start sharing my screen. Okay. So for me, I think since we are running short of time, maybe we'll give 30 seconds for each spotter and then we can go to the answer. So without wasting time, going to spotter number one. This is a 60-year-old woman having diabetes and hypertension, complaining of progressive dyspnea. X-ray chest showed cardiomegaly with the congested lungs. ECG is shown below. You can see the ECG. So, 60-year-old woman, non-diabetic and hypertensive, coming with the progressive dyspnea. One has to think of coronary artery disease, ischemic cardiomyopathy or dilated cardiomyopathy. So she was taken up for right heart and CAG. Okay. Now, right heart cath showed that her RA pressure was 8, RV was 50/10. On advancing the Swan scans into the pulmonary artery, she complained of chest pain and dizziness. BP falls to 80/50 millimeters of mercury, and the ECG is as follows. So an ECG, which was like this, now turns like this. So now what will you do? Give IV atropine 1 mg, place a temporary pacemaker, start dopamine infusion, reposition the Swan Ganz catheter, or perform RCA angiogram and angioplasty. 30 seconds. I'll show you the ECG second.
Time up, sir.
Okay. So what has happened was she initially had left bundle branch block. So this could have been new onset LBB, or this could have been congenital LBB. Congenital LBB with the now presenting with DCM, or new onset LBB and presenting with ischemic cardiomyopathy, acute MI and LBB. So she was taken up for right heart cath. When while doing a right heart cath, she suddenly develops complete heart block. A patient, RBB can occur during right heart catheterization. So you had LBB. Now while doing a right heart cath, the Swan Ganz catheter will hit the right bundle branch and it will cause complete heart block. So as this patient had pre-existing LBB, he went for complete heart block. Appropriate initial action should be withdraw the catheter from the right heart. Once you remove it from the from hitting the right bundle, immediately revert to LBB. If CHB persists after withdrawing the catheter, then put a TPI. Atropine will not be of use as this block is infranodal. And can CHB occur with left-sided cardiac catheterization of patient with pre-existing RBB? This is unlikely because the right bundle is a single fascicle. So the catheter can go and hit it. But whereas the left bundle divides into two fascicles, left anterior and left posterior. So if you thought your catheter can hit any one fascicle, so it is unlikely to happen in a patient with pre-existing RBB that while doing a left heart cath you cause a complete heart block. Now coming to question number two. This is a patient with symptoms of claudication. So he is undergoing an ABI test. So this is his right arm pressure, 120, left arm pressure, 100. His right ankle pressure, posterior tibial is 68, dorsal speed is 64. Left ankle posterior tibial is 136, dorsal speed is 134. Now calculate the right and left ABI of this patient. 30 seconds.
Time up, sir.
Okay. See, how to calculate ABI is, now for the right side, derived ABI is equal to higher of the right ankle pressure, whichever posterior tibial or dorsal speed is. So here the higher is 68. So you put this 68. Then higher of the arm pressure, it is not right arm. If the left is higher, you can take the left also. So here right only is higher. So take this 120. So 68 by 120, it is 0.57. Now left ABI. So higher of the left ankle, here the higher is posterior tibial 136. So take that. And higher of the arm pressure, here arm pressure higher is on the right side. So take that 120. It is coming as 1.13. I mean, why this is being shown is that while taking the arm pressure, you should take whichever is the higher, not the same side. For a right ankle, here you are using the right, but for a left, here you are using the right arm. So that is the reason why this has been shown, and this is how you should calculate your ankle brachial index. And the lowest of these numbers is the patient's overall ABI. So here the lowest is 0.57. So the overall ABI of this patient is 0.57. Okay, going to question number three. How and for which group is vasoreactivity test done? No, we know now for PAH you do vasoreactivity test. And a positive acute response to vasoreactivity testing is defined as A, decrease of 10% of PAP mean to a value of less than 40 with preserved or increased cardiac output. Decrease of 10 millimeter, here it is 10%, here it is 10 millimeter of PAP, mean value of less than 40 with preserved or increased cardiac output. Here both it is preserved or increased cardiac output. Now again the same, decrease of 10% in PAP mean to a value of less than 40 with a 10% increase in cardiac output. And again, a decrease in 10 millimeter in PAP mean to a value of less than 40 with a 10% increase in cardiac output. Now, which of this is true? And for which group is vasoreactive testing done? So, 30 seconds.
Time up, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So the positive acute response to vasoreactive testing is defined as B is the answer. There should be a decrease in 10 millimeter of mean PAP, not 10%, to a value of less than 40 millimeters of mercury, and with the preserved or increased cardiac output. Not necessary that there should be an increase in cardiac output. It could be the same or it could increase. So this is the positive acute response. So where do you do vasoreactive test? In PAH, vasoreactivity testing should be done at the time of diagnostic right heart catheterization to identify patients who may benefit from long-term therapy with calcium channel blockers. Vasoreactivity test is not recommended in groups 2, 3, 4, and 5. So it is only done for group 1 PAH patients. It is recommended in group 1 PAH where only 10% of patients are responders. So if you take 100% 100 patients in group 1 PH and you do vasoreactive test, only for 10 will be responders. And only for them, if you give calcium channel blockers, it will be useful. Others will be non-responders. Even in responders, over years, say 5 to 7 years, they also become non-responders. And even in group 1, heritable PH, connective tissue disease PH, congenital heart disease PH, HIV PH, it is not recommended. It's not useful. And this should not be done with oral or IV calcium channel blockers in acute vasoreactivity testing. So one should not use calcium channel blockers to do this vasoreactivity testing. So this is the classification of PH. You have group 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So this testing is not useful in this 2, 3, 4, 5 groups, only in group 1. And even in group 1, heritable PH, connective tissue disease, HIV infection and congenital heart disease, you should not do vasoreactivity testing. So how it is done? You can give nitric oxide by inhalation. The dosage is 10 to 20 parts per million. Or you can give epoprostenol IV, 2 to 12 nanogram per kg per minute. Or adenosine IV, 50 to 350 mics per kg per minute. Remember that both epoprostenol and adenosine have risk of systemic vasodilation and fall in blood pressure. So patients with borderline blood pressure, you should not use these two agents. Even borderline BP, you can give nitric oxide inhalation. It is not going to affect the systemic pressures. And positive acute responder, as I said, is reduction of mean PAP more than 10 to reach an absolute value of mean PAP less than 44 with an increased or unchanged cardiac output. So coming to question number 4. This is a right heart cath in a patient with PHT on echo. So his right atrial pressure is 8, RV is 68 bar 8, pulmonary artery systolic 68, diastolic 32, mean 43. Pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is 25. His cardiac output is 3 liters per minute and his cardiac index is 1.5 liter per minute. Now, what is his PVR? Expressed in Wood units. Answer A18, B466, C12 and D6 Wood units. And then classify what type of PAH is this. So since this involves calculation, we will give 45 seconds. So how you calculate PVR is, the formula is mean pulmonary artery pressure minus pulmonary capillary wedge pressure divided by cardiac output. So the mean pulmonary artery pressure here is 43. 43 minus pulmonary capillary wedge pressure 25. So 43 by 25 and cardiac output is 3 liters per minute divided by 3 is equal to 6 Wood units. So the answer is 6 Wood units. Now the PVR is expressed in Wood units, but the PVR here in this patient is coming as more than 3 Wood units. Normally it should be around less than 3 Wood units. So if it is more than 3, it points to out of proportion PHT. So how do you classify pulmonary hypertension? So pulmonary hypertension, you look for the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So this indicates that the level of obstruction is behind the capillaries, post-capillary, and here the obstruction is before the capillaries, pre-capillary. Here, since the obstruction is pre-capillary, the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure will be less than 15. Since there is no obstruction here, the wedge pressure will be less than 15. But whereas here, in left heart disease, the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure will be more than 15. So if you check a pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and it is more than 15, it indicates that this is a group 2 pulmonary hypertension. So our patient has a group 2 PAH. Then you have to calculate the transpulmonary gradient. So what is the transpulmonary gradient? It is the fall in pressure from the pulmonary circulation to the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So change in pressure across the pulmonary circulation from the main pulmonary artery to the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So that is the transpulmonary gradient and it is less than 10 millimeters of mercury normally. So the transpulmonary gradient is mean PAP minus mean pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, and here the transpulmonary gradient is 18. So if the transpulmonary gradient is more than 18, then what does it mean? And another way of calculating PVR is transpulmonary gradient divided by cardiac output. You get in Wood units, same 18 by 3, you get 6 Wood units. And if you want in dynes per second centimeter to the power of 5, you multiply it by 80. You will get this in dynes per centimeter, which is 480. So now this patient, the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is more than 18. It indicates that it is reactive post-capillary pulmonary hypertension. If it is less than 12, it indicates it is passive post-capillary pulmonary hypertension. So our patient here has PAH type 2 due to left heart disease with reactive post-capillary pulmonary hypertension. Now coming to question number 5. 46-year-old hypertensive, echo during routine master checkup shows this in the long axis and short axis view. Now, what is the abnormality you see and cause for the same? How will you classify this abnormality? And what are the echocardiographic parameters required to classify this abnormality? 30 seconds.
Time up, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So this patient is having concentric LVH. You can see LVH. Normally, you measure the thickness of the IVS in diastole and systole and then give the dimensions. And if it is normally, it should be less than 12. If it is more than 12, we call it as LVH. So the differential diagnosis will be commonest will be systemic hypertension. Then aortic stenosis, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, amyloidosis, athlete's heart, mitochondrial disease, Fabry's disease, Danon's or Pompe's. These are the various causes for this kind of a concentric LVH. Now, whenever you see concentric LVH, you should classify whether it is concentric hypertrophy, eccentric hypertrophy, or concentric remodeling. Now, how do you say that whether it is one of these three types? For which you need one is LV mass index and the other is relative wall thickness. So, what are the parameters you required for calculating this? Across the parastinal long axis view, you'll have to take the IVS dimension, the LV posterior wall dimension, and then feed this left ventricular end diastolic dimension, IVS dimension, posterior wall dimension, and then you need the height and weight also. Once you feed this, the calculate the echocardiograph machine will automatically calculate for you the LV mass and the LV mass index and the regional wall thickness. Once you know this three, then you can classify as to what it is. So if it is concentric LVH, there will be global LV wall thickness. See the thickness. The normal LV cavity size, LV cavity is normal. And there will be increased LV mass and increased regional wall thickness. If it is eccentric LVH, you will have normal global LV wall thickness. So there is no increased thickness unlike in these two types, concentric and eccentric. So this, there will be increased LV cavity size. There will be increased in LV mass, but decreased in regional wall thickness. Where if it is concentric remodeling, you will have again LV wall thickness increased, but normal or small LV cavity size. Normal LV mass, but increased regional wall thickness. So based on this, you can classify whether it is concentric LVH, eccentric LVH, or concentric remodeling. Going to question number 6. This is a 64-year-old lady with breast cancer, underwent radical mastectomy and was undergoing chemotherapy, comes to the emergency with acute onset breathlessness. What are your findings?
Time up, sir.
No. So that was the Hamptons Hub. You see this triangle shape, wedge-shaped shadow, that is the Hamptons Hub. It is a wedge-shaped plural-based consolidation with a rounded convex apex always directed towards the island. The design was first described by Omri Otis Hampton. It is usually encountered at the lower lobes and heals with scar formation. This indicates that the lung has got infarcted. What are the other X-ray findings in acute pulmonary embolism? You can have this Westermark sign. This is decrease of vascularization at the periphery of the lungs due to mechanical obstruction or reflex vasoconstriction in the pulmonary artery. So this may not be necessarily because of thrombus in the pulmonary artery. Sometimes the vasospasm involved because of thrombus also can cause this. And see, you can see here, clearly there is an area of decreased pulmonary vascularity. So this is Westermark sign. This indicates that there is a massive central pulmonary artery occlusion. Then you can have Pallas sign, which is enlarged right descending pulmonary artery, which indicates that the right descending pulmonary artery has got occluded. So these are the three signs. This is one X-ray where you can see all the three findings. You can see this Hampton's hump, triangular shaped wedge shadow here. You can see Westermark sign, decreased pulmonary vascularity in this area. And you can see the prominent right descending pulmonary artery, the Pallas sign. So these are the signs one should look for in a case of acute pulmonary edema: the Westermark sign, the Pallas sign, the Hampton's hump. And melting sign is infarct showing rapid clearing in contrast to pneumonic consolidation. So rapid clearance of the wedge-shaped shadow is also known as melting sign. And prominent common pulmonary artery is Fleischner's sign. So coming to question number 7. A 65-year-old diabetic and hypertensive gentleman having chronic stable angina since 6 months underwent a thallium scan. Interpret the thallium scan and what are the high-risk features in stress thallium? 30 seconds.
Time up, sir.
Ah, thank you. So this is a planar imaging showing the lung uptake, and you can see increased lung uptake. And here you can see always in stress images, they show on a short axis view, a horizontal long axis view, and a vertical long axis view. They show the stress images first and the rest images later. Now, if you see here, compared to the rest image, you see apical dropout. So this indicates that there is apical dropout or hyperperfusion in this apex. It is an LAD territory. So probably this patient is having a lesion in the LAD. And then again, if you see in the vertical long axis, you see in the inferior wall also there is dropout. You see here normal perfusion. You see here less perfusion. So double vessel disease. Now the circumflex is also involved. So that's what you can say with this imaging. The increased lung uptake in the planar scan imaging, apical reversible perfusion defect, ischemia in LAD territory, and you can see transient ischemic dilatation, LV cavity dilatation. See here, the LV cavity is small, but here you see the SLV cavity looks to be bigger. So transient ischemic LV cavity dilatation, the stress image are all indicators of bad disease. So the thallium lung uptake normally is not to that great an extent. But when you have increased lung uptake, it means that either patient is having severe CAD, decreased ejection fraction, or elevated pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. The elevated pulmonary capillary wedge pressure causes slow transit of the thallium in the lungs and more extraction. So that is why you get increased lung uptake. And this transient ischemic dilatation happens in left main disease, proximal LAD disease, multivessel disease, or diffuse subendocardial ischemia. So what are the high-risk features of thallium in patient? Post-stress EF if it falls to less than 35%, stress-induced large perfusion defect, stress-induced multiple perfusion defects of moderate size, or large fixed perfusion defect with LV dilatation or increased lung uptake, and stress-induced moderate perfusion defects with LV dilatation or increased lung uptake are indicators of bad prognosis. Now coming to spotter number 8. So what is your, what is the diagnosis, or what is the sign that you are seeing here? Where do you get this sign, and what are the other echocardiographic features of this condition? This is a quite an easy spotter.
Time up, sir.
Okay, thank you. So this is a TR jet being recorded, and you can see the TR gradient, and then you have to add that to the right atrial pressure. How do you derive this right atrial pressure? Measure the IVC more than 2.1. If the collapse is less than 50%, add 50. More than 50%, add 8. If it is less than 2.1 centimeter, less than 50% collapse, add 8. More than 50, add 3. So this tricuspid gradient 4 into your, you will calculate this and then add to this RA pressure, you get the PA pressure. And this is your RV outflow pulmonary artery velocity, and you calculate the pulmonary acceleration time, which is from the beginning to the peak of this wave. So if both is less than 60, PA pressure is less than 60 millimeters of mercury, and pulmonary acceleration time is less than 60, it is known as the 60-60 sign. So the 60-60 sign is an echocardiographic, refers to the coexistence of a truncated right ventricular outflow tract acceleration time less than 60 milliseconds with a PA systolic pressure of less than 60, but more than 30. It is not normal. In the presence of right ventricular failure, it is consistent with an acute elevation in afterload, commonly due to acute pulmonary embolism. So it's commonly seen in pulmonary embolism. What are the other features you will see in pulmonary embolism? The parasternal long axis view will show you an enlarged right ventricle, and Dr. Murli showed you this mechanical sign. The RV will be hypokinetic, but except for the apex, which is spared and will be hypercontracting. The parasternal short axis will show you the D-shaped septum, the flat interventricular septum. The IVC will be distended, and there will be loss of inspiratory collapsibility. The 60/60 sign, which we just saw. If you are lucky, sometimes you can see a thrombus in transit from the RA to RV. And the TAPC, if you calculate, will always be less than 16 millimeter. And in tissue Doppler, if you see, there is decreased peak systolic S prime velocity of tricuspid annulus will be less than 9.5. So these are the features one should look for in acute pulmonary embolism: RV enlargement, hypomechanical sign, D-shaped septum, tricuspid regurgitation, lack of inspiratory collapse of IVC, direct visualization of thrombus, and 60/60 sign. Okay, going to question number 9. A 38-year-old male having heart failure with normal LV function shows the following MOD finding. What is the diagnosis, and what are the other echo findings in this condition? 30 seconds, please.
Time up, sir.
Thank you. So this is the MOD. What you see is the septal bounce. The septal bounce is the brisk early diastolic IVS motion towards the LV. So this is inspiration, and it is moving towards the LV, followed by a rebound in the opposite direction during expiration. So this is expiration, and you can see it moving towards the RV. So this is known as septal bounce. When you see a septal bounce in a patient with heart failure but preserved ejection fraction, you'll have to think of constriction, constrictive pericarditis. And the hemodynamic equivalent of that septal bounce is this discordant ventricular pressures. See, when the, if you take a simultaneous pressure tracing of the LV and RV, when the LV pressure rises, the RV pressure falls. And when the RV pressure rises, the the LV pressure falls. This is because the septum keeps moving this way or the other way. If it reduces the volume of one ventricle, it will increase the volume of the other ventricle. So these are known as discordant pressure patterns of LV and RV. So this indicates constrictive pericarditis. If they are concordant, it indicates restrictive cardiomyopathy. So the other echo features are ventricular septal shift, mitral inflow restrictive with or without respiratory variation, apatic and diastolic flow reversal with expiration, and then you see these two signs, annulus paradoxus and annulus reversus in constrictive pericarditis. In annulus paradoxus, the mitral medial annulus E velocity is more than 7 centimeters per second. Normally, it is lesser than the lateral. And in mitral lateral E, if it is less than the medial E, most of the times, then it is annulus reversus. Coming to spotter number 10, this is the pressure volume loop. Compared to the normal pressure volume loop showed with solid lines on the left, the pressure volume loop to the right would be of this condition. HOCM, restrictive cardiomyopathy, dilated cardiomyopathy, pericardial constriction, or mitral stenosis. 30 seconds.
Time up, sir.
Thank you. So, one should understand the basic pressure volume loop. In a pressure volume loop, events happening are here, the mitral valve is opening, then blood flows into the LV from the LA. So the LV gets filled up, and that is why, see, this represents your volume and this represents your pressure. So here the volume is increasing and the pressure is increasing slightly. So that is happened during LV filling. And then here mitral valve gets closed. After mitral valve gets closed, you have isovolumic contraction. So during this phase, you can see only the pressure is rising, but the volume is not increasing or decreasing because both the valves are closed. Then after isovolumic contraction, the aortic valve opens. That is when the pressure in the LV, which goes up, and when it exceeds 80 millimeters, it opens the aortic valve. So once aortic valve opens, the blood flows from the LV into the aorta. So this is the basically the LV emptying or LV ejection. And this represents the afterload. When you have increase in afterload, this goes up. When you have decrease in afterload, this comes down. And then this is the aortic valve closing. Once the aortic valve closes, after that you have the isovolumic relaxation period, during which there is only fall in pressure, but no change in volume. And this represents the stroke volume, so the amount of blood being ejected. So here, this is the end systolic volume, which will be around 50 to 60 ml. Here you have the end diastolic volume, which will be around 120 or 30 ml. So when the end diastolic volume increases, it will move to the right. When the end systolic volume decreases, it will move to the left. So that is how you should interpret a pressure volume loop. Now, if you look at the conditions given, dilated cardiomyopathy, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, or restrictive cardiomyopathy, you will have to look for the end systolic volume, end diastolic volume, and contractility. Now, for example, take for dilated cardiomyopathy, end systolic volume increases. This is the end systolic volume. If it increases, it comes here. Then the end diastolic volume also increases. So this also moves here. So this has moved to the right. And if you see, the contractility is decreased. Once the contractility is decreased, the height of the is will come down. And then when the contractility decreases, the stroke volume will fall. So if you see the width also, it will come down. So this is the pressure volume loop of a dilated cardiomyopathy. Now what will happen in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy? The end systolic volume is decreased. So it moves to the left. The end diastolic volume also is decreased. So again, this also moves to this place. So, and if you see the contractility, it is increased. So it will become wider than the normal curve. So this is the pressure volume loop of a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patient. And in restrictive cardiomyopathy, you see the end systolic volume decreases or remains normal. The end diastolic volume decreases or remains normal. And the contractility also decreases normal. So it almost represents a normal curve. It stays in the same position. Dilated cardiomyopathy, it will move to the right. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, it will move to the left and above. And restricted cardiomyopathy will almost stay there. So this is the pressure volume loop of a patient with dilated cardiomyopathy. Now coming to spotter number 11. All of the following increase the gradient in HCM except Valsalva maneuver, squatting, amyl nitrate. So one should understand the hemodynamics in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Whenever there is a decrease in the ventricular volume, decrease in the blood pressure, or increase in contractility, the gradient increases, murmur increases. But whereas when there is increased ventricular volume, increased blood pressure, or decreased contractility, the gradient decreases and the murmur also decreases. Why this happens is because when there is decreased ventricular volume, the SAM happens more. So the obstruction becomes more. But when there is increased ventricular volume, the SAM will be reduced. So there will be lesser gradient. So if you see the various physiological and pharmacological maneuvers, Valsalva, amyl nitrate, and isoproterenolol decreases the ventric volume. So it increases the gradient and increases the murmur. Whereas hand grip, phenylephrine, and beta blocker increase the ventricular volume, decrease the gradient, and decrease the murmur. So if you come to our question, Valsalva maneuver decreases the venous volume, hence increases the murmur. Squatting increases the venous return, but decreases the murmur. So squatting is the wrong answer. Others all will increase. Amyl nitrate, vasodilation, tachycardia, both decrease the ventricular volume, increase the murmur. Isoproterenol increase contractility and decrease ventricular volume increases the murmur. So squatting is the answer. Coming to question number 12. I know everyone will answer this. So question is what sign is this? This is Brockenbrock-Grönwald sign. Now what are the changes seen in this sign? And there are four changes seen. And which of this change got its name Brockenbrock-Grönwald sign? 30 seconds. Okay, there is another question in this also. All of the following are true of Brockenbrock-Grönwald response, except there is increased filling of the LV with compensatory pause. The premature beat causes a decrease in contractility in HCM, but not in normal individuals. There is an increase in ventricular pressure in both normal individuals and HCM. There is a decrease in aortic pressure in HCM. There is an increase in aortic pressure in normal individuals. Which of this is false?
Time up, sir.
Okay. So if you see the pressure changes that happen in this post-extrasystolic potentiation is there is a fall in the aortic pressure. You see the aortic pressure here, it has fallen down. Then there is a rise in the LV pressure. See the LV pressure here and see the LV pressure here. So there is a rise in LV pressure. There is an increase in gradient. See the gradient here and see the gradient here. So there has been increase in the gradient. And there is a fall in the pulse pressure. So this is the pulse pressure of the aorta. And this is the pulse pressure of the post-extrasystolic beat. So there is a fall in pulse pressure. It is this fall in pulse pressure that gives its name of Roggenberg-Grönwald sign, not the other three changes. So, and another thing you will see is, you will see the post-ectopic beat showing a spike and dome pattern. This is the spike and dome pattern. So these are the characteristic features seen in a Roggenberg-Grönwald sign. Now, among these features, the one which is wrong is B. See, normally there is increased filling of the LV with compensatory pulse. The premature beat causes a decrease in contracting in HCM but not in normal individuals is wrong. The Roggenberg-Grönwald sign causes the contracting to increase in both normal individuals and in patients with HCM. And the increase in ventricular pressure in both normal and HCM is correct. Decrease in aortic pressure in HCM is correct. Increase in aortic pressure in normal individuals is correct. Coming to question number 13. What is the ocular abnormality and what are the syndromes associated with this abnormality? I don't want all the 30 seconds. I don't want all the dysmorphic features, just the ocular features I know.
Time up, sir.
Okay. So, if you look at this albumic, if you look at this palpebral fissures, they are oblique. They are slanting down like this. That is the dysmorphic feature seen. So, normal palpebral fissures are horizontal like this. If they tilt down medially, it is known as mongoloid slant. If they tilt upwards medially, it is known as anti-mongoloid slant. So, this mongoloid slant is seen in Down syndrome and Alagille syndrome. In Down syndrome, in addition to this mongoloid slant, patient has a flat nasal bridge, medial epicanthal folds, and small ears. The anti-mongoloid slant, which goes up, you see in Kreidu-Chatt syndrome and Apert syndrome, both are associated with VSD. Okay. Going to the question number 14. What is being done and where do you need this? 30 seconds.
Time up, sir.
Okay. So this is rapid ventricular pacing. You can see the ECG here beating normally at a heart rate of around 70, and then suddenly you see rapid right ventricular pacing being done. And you can see the rate around 140 to 160. And if you look at the aortic pressure, the pressure which was around 140 by 100 now suddenly falls down to 60. So this is rapid ventricular pacing. This is used whenever you want to make the heart stop. You don't want blood to flow into the aorta, you don't want the heart to move for some intervention, we do this rapid ventricular pacing. The indications where we do rapid right ventricular pacing are for coarctation stenting. We don't want the aorta to move, otherwise stent will slip. In pulmonary or artery balloon valvotomy, otherwise the force of the RV contraction or LV contraction will push off the balloon. So when you do rapid ventricular pacing, the balloon won't slip away. For diagnostic catch with rotational angio, you need the heart to be still. For ostial stenting, if you want to catch the LAD ostium or the circumflex ostium, then you need to do a rapid ventricular pacing so that the heart won't move. And then in TAVI, TVAR and EVAR also, you do rapid ventricular pacing. Similarly, in TVAR, if you want to place the position in TVAR or EVAR exactly, then you have to do a rapid ventricular pacing. Now, coming to the last question. These are two X-ray chests, not of the same patient, different patients. Now, what is the diagnosis for this X-ray? Diagnosis for this X-ray, what is the LA pressure here and what is the LA pressure here? Thirty seconds.
Time up, sir.
Okay, thank you. We can correlate the left atrial pressure approximately with the changes in the X-ray. The normal LA pressure is around 5 to 10 millimeters of mercury. When you have cephalization, then the LA pressure is 10 to 15 millimeters of mercury. If you see curly B lines in X-ray, then your LA pressure is 15 to 20. If you see interstitial edema, your LA pressure is 20 to 25. Only when it exceeds 25, you get pulmonary alveolar edema or acute pulmonary edema. So this is cephalization. When you see the pulmonary veins prominent in the upper lobe than in the basal or mid lobe, then it is known as cephalization. This indicates that the pulmonary venous pressure is 10 to 15 millimeters of mercury or LA pressure is 10 to 15. This cephalization means pulmonary venous hypertension so long as the person is erect when the chest X-ray is obtained. This will not be seen if you are taking the patient in the lying down posture. Then curly B lines are short white lines perpendicular to the pleural surface at the lung base. This curly B lines indicate that the LA pressure is 15 to 20 millimeters. This is pulmonary interstitial edema and this is pulmonary alveolar edema. When you see pulmonary edema, it spills over from the interstitium to the air spaces. Here, fluid doesn't enter the air spaces. It is only located in the interstitium. Here, it enters the alveoli. Then this is pulmonary flooding or the patient is drowned. So here you get a bat wing like pattern of pattern. Whereas here you see a diffuse haziness. So here in pulmonary interstitial edema, it is around 20 to 25 and here it is more than 25. Thank you. So I'll stop sharing my screen. Yes, sir. Would you like to comment anything, sir, Dr. Shanmugasundaram and Dr. T.R. Muralidharan? With your comments, I think we can close this session.
I think we're done. All right. I think we'll have the next session on Monday. What I would do is I would predominantly, confine myself to the clinical examination details. I think we have shown enough of pressure traces, echo traces. But both of you can show my tracings and ECGs. What I do is I will confine myself to the clinical phenomena, like clinical. Maybe I can have a unmanned case presentation so that it will be useful for them for the examinations.
Sure, sir. Sure. And even if they give a feedback as to what they want, maybe we can focus on that also. If they want oximetries, if they want pressure tracing, whatever they want, we can show for the next session.
We have some feedbacks from many of the PDs also, sir, when we personally send this invitation also. I'll share you, sir, so that you can corner with both of them and create some platform of the same, sir.
Okay. TRM, sir, you are?
Yeah, I can. See, today it was more like hemodynamics, echocardiogram, and few ECG. If RRR and you agree, maybe I'll spend time on EP and arrhythmias, ECGs for post exam going or DM level discussion. We can do as you said, we can discuss it, whatever.
Okay. Maybe in 1 or 2 days we'll get the feedback from the PGs, sir, and then accordingly we'll allot and we can do it.
Yeah. In fact, shall I suggest one thing, sir? They can put the PGs can write the feedback, any specific questions, anything that we can answer.
Sir, we are already putting in the chat column. Already a lot of questions are there, sir. Now we will compile everything and we'll bring it to
center. The questions that are asked by many people will have a priority naturally.
Maybe we can prepare spotters on those questions also for the next.
Definitely. Sure, sir. Thank you. It's a wonderful evening. Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
TRM. Thank you,
sir. Thank you,
TRM, sir. Yes. Over to
Dhanajay
and Sriram.
Thank you, Sriram.
Thank you, sir. It was nice having all three pioneers of cardiologists in our show, in the evening show. Because I'm sure all the PGs will be benefited of the discussions which we had and of the teachings which you have shown to them. I'm sure, sir, the next program, we can still add something what they need. Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks for the wonderful. And thanks to all the PGs who also made this program a great, eventful program. Thank you.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
பரவாயில்லங்க 200 பிளஸ் வந்திருக்கும் ஐ திங்க் நார்த் இந்தியால இருந்து வந்திருக்காங்க
நம்ம லீவ் பண்ணலாமா
அது யாவா ஐ அம் எண்டிங் தி மீட்டிங்